All right, let me see what I have. We continue now with chapter 18. Chapter 18, and now we're section 3, which is loanable funds. Now let me see. Okay, so we just begin very simple. What is a loanable fund? We usually use the word funds in English in plural. Funds means sources of money. Sources of money. Where money? So, loanable funds is simply money available for borrowing and lending. Is money available for, on the one side is lending, on the other side is borrowing. Okay. All right, let's write this out a little bit. Credit. I think I wrote this. Did I write it last time? I'll write it again for you. Credit always has two parties. One is called a borrower.
Lender.
Yes. And the other one is a lender. The lender we call also creditor. Again, a big part of this course is learning the words, what the word means, okay? What the word exactly means, okay? Like, everybody knows what means a woman and a man, right? But actually, what's the definition? Can't find. I always ask the same question, and usually I need about 500 students for one to know the definition of man and the definition of woman. What's the definition of man? What is the definition? What does it mean to a man? What's the definition of a woman? Of course, it's a hard question because even doctors have hard times. It's on. The definition is what is the contents of the 23rd chromosome? The contents can be XX and XY. If the last chromosome it has the same identical part, we call it a woman. If they're different, we call it a man. This is the strict technical. It's called genomic. All other definitions fail for too many reasons. Okay, like the obvious one, long hair, short hair, no hair. Okay, there are men with long hair and there are women without too, right? So, again, you need to understand the exact meaning of every word. What we mean, in this case, economics. So, lender is the same as creditor. Okay, so, credit is the same word as loan. Okay. And loanable funds means money available for credit and money available for loans. Okay. So, this is the money. On the one side represents the supply, on the other side represents the demand. Now I need, I don't have my green color. Okay, without green color. Here, I'm gonna, which one is the supply, which one is the demand? The supply, the the demand. Supply, demand. There's money.
The supply.
Supply, demand, the customer affected the demand.
So who wants the money?
The
borrower wants the money. So the borrower will represent the demand. Demand for loanable funds. Well, this, the second one is a lot easier. If you save the money, this is money that's available for, this is the supply for loanable funds. Supply for loanable funds. Okay. So now we got a demand and you got a supply, which means that you can draw simple and easy chart. Here is Q, which represents quantity, and here is price. This is the quantity of loanable funds. Okay, this is the quantity of loanable funds. And this is the price. Now comes the question, well, let's first answer the easier part. Supply and demand. Okay, so somehow demand will be like this, is right, D. Supply will be here, and now comes here the equilibrium. That's the easy question. The question now is, what is the price of loanable funds? What is the price? The point where they meet is called equilibrium point. But the question is, what is the price? What is the meaning of price? What is the price for a loan? What is the price? How do we measure? How do we price the loan? What's the meaning of price for a loan?
They give you money and they take benefit.
Oh, and they take the benefit. Now, let's write it out. We did it last week with you, right? We said, you borrow 9,000 and you pay back 11,000, you pay back 9 plus 2. The price of the loan is 2,000. The price of the loan is 2,000. Okay.
This is interest.
Yes! Now we are coming. This is the perfect answer. The perfect answer is this is the interest. So, the price of the loan is exactly the same as interest rate. So, here, price is equal to interest rate. Correct. Now, let me just write it in. Very simple and very easy, but it's nice to write. First, if interest rate goes up, let's say the bank pays 1%, which is little, you're going to save little money. But if the bank pays 5%, you will save more. If the bank pays 15%, you will save a lot more. So, as interest rate goes up, saving goes up. People will save more if they're offered higher interest rate. That's very easy.
For the bank or for the customer?
We call these people people, okay, they have a special name. They're called, in English, let's write it in red so that we make sure everybody knows it. They have a name, they're called savers.
The customer, the
saver,
or the bank?
Saver is someone who saves money. Anybody who saves money, if the government saves money, the government is a saver. If a business saves money, the business is a saver. If I save money, I'm a saver. Anybody, anyone who saves money is called a saver. That's the definition of a saver.
Doctor, I know if anybody will save money from you. What about the interest rate? You wrote here the interest rate, it will be more. The saving will be more.
Right. If the interest rate is higher, you will prefer to save more to get more income. I will prefer to save more to get more income.
Okay.
Now, when interest rate is low, like zero, we discover people don't want to save money. There's no reward for saving. In other words, interest rate is the reward to save money. The higher the interest rate, the more you want to save. Same applies for government. The same applies for anybody. If you offer them more money, they will save more. If you offer them less, they will save less. This is called in economics incentive.
Okay.
Now, the opposite is also very, very, very true. If you can borrow for 1%, you borrow a lot of money. If the interest rate is 5, you borrow less. But if interest rate becomes 15, businesses, governments, individuals, banks will borrow less. So, higher interest rate means that borrowing goes down, same as demand goes down. So, savings represents supply. All we are saying that supply of loanable funds increases with interest rate. Demand for loanable funds decreases with interest rate. Okay. And this here is the equilibrium. Equilibrium interest rate and equilibrium price. Okay. So is this so far clear? Okay. So we got the loanable funds, we got the borrowers represent demand, we got the savers represents supply. Okay. And this represents the quantity of saving. Okay. So this quantity represents now two things. It's equal to the saving on the one end, but from here is equal to the investment on the other end. Okay. Now, you should have studied in microeconomics. What if the price is a little bit higher? Oh, okay, let's do that here. If interest rate is higher, demand is low, supply is high, and the difference when supply is higher than demand, we call this positive balance, okay, is called a surplus. Okay, now again, microeconomics is that if interest rate is too low, demand will be higher. Excellent. Wow, is this a bonus point?
Yeah, for the midterm.
And you have a shortage.
Okay. Is this so far good? Okay. So, interest rate is too high, you get a surplus of loanable funds. Okay. In other words, you have too many savers. No, if interest rate is high, you have a surplus. Means too many savers and not enough borrowers. If the interest rate is too low, you have too many borrowers and too few savers. You have shortage of funds. So now the next question you need to write it is, what is the function of the interest rate in the economy?
What is the function?
Of the interest rate of the economy. Well, okay, again, we make it in two parts. What is the meaning of interest rate? And what is its function? Now, the last one there, please make sure, the one behind, right?
So could we take the answer from the question? What is the interest rate?
The answer, I was explaining it for the last 10 minutes.
No, I know, but just a
minute. You just wanted, in one sentence, right?
The best option.
The best answer is, please write these questions for the midterm for your missing friends. Okay. And please tell your missing friend that she is getting absences last time and she's getting absences today because she's not in class, doesn't show up, and she's accumulating absences, okay? So please give her this question so she knows. Okay, so back to the question. What is the meaning of interest rate? The meaning of interest rate is the price of borrowing or the price of lending, but it happens to be the same as the price of saving,
investment,
the price of investment, and the price of capital. So, interest rate is, now we're switching back, changing. The most important of all prices in the economy, the most important price of all prices in the economy, because it is the price of capital. And capital is the most important good in the economy. In other words, everything in the economy depends on capital.
The capital is the good.
Is the most important good in the economy. And interest rate is its price, and therefore is the most important price in the economy. Okay? Now, the way I wrote it last time, and the way I explained it again, and I'll just write it one more time to be absolutely sure that, again, this form of interest rate represents, I'll write it in red, the cost of capital. I wrote it before, I'll write it again. Cost of capital. Okay, the cost of capital. Because the capital is the most important commodity for any economy, interest rate is the cost of capital. When I say cost, I mean price of capital. Price of capital. And again, why is it important? Because the interest rate makes balance. The function of interest rate is to balance borrowing and lending.
It
The interest rate function is to balance borrowing and lending in the economy. In other words, it balances vulnerable funds. It balances borrowers and lenders. Now, let me again explain slowly just to be absolutely sure, because I received, surprisingly, an answer from a fourth year graduating student who told me that interest rate was low, interest rate was good, and high interest rate was bad, which is wrong, totally wrong, okay? Low interest rate is, let's repeat, good for borrowers, bad for savers. High interest rate is opposite. Good for savers, bad for borrowers. He believed it's good for society. The answer is no. Most of the society saves. If the government saves, it's bad for the government. When businesses save, it's bad for businesses. When households save, it's bad for households. It's bad for savers, okay? So, also, low interest rate is bad for the banking system, okay? Why? Because low interest rate means the banks will have shortage of funds, okay? High interest rate is bad for the banking system. Why? Really? Because the banks don't have a surplus of funds. In other words, the banks don't have an awful lot of money and nothing to do with it, nowhere to invest it, okay? So, this interest rate balances the banking system, makes the banking system in balance. It balances savers and it balances investors, okay? And now we come back to the one last piece. I'll have to see, is it at the end of the chapter or the beginning of the chapter? I'll have to see where it is. I began with the number one last time, the banking system. And I explained you need to prepare two main instruments of the financial system, stock and bond, okay? You need to prepare two markets, stock market, bond market, right? And you need to prepare two main institutions, banks and mutual funds, okay? The banks were mostly in credit and associated with borrowing and lending and bonds. And mutual funds are associated mostly with stocks and equity. The one is called debt capital, the other one is called equity capital. Okay, debt financing, equity financing. So, now going back to the financial system, the function, which is the same as the purpose of the financial system, is to distribute savings in the economy to their most profitable investments in the economy. Remember, savings always equal investments. The function, they're always the same, but the function of the commercial banks in general, of the whole financial system, is to channel savings to the, now is the key word, most productive investments in the economy. This means most productive credits, most productive loans, and most productive stocks in the economy. In other words, the financial function, by channeling savings to investments, the function is to create the most productive form of capital and to contribute to, I wrote it here, standard of living, blue collar, standard of living, rising GDP is the same as growth. Economic. Now, back to the one to write the question, right? The question is, how does the financial system... Yes. How does the financial system... What's the question? You guys, you need to be able to guess the question. You need to make an intelligent, educated guess based on the last 10 minutes of what I'm talking about. What's the question?
What does financial system mean?
No, that was the first part. Again?
It's working. How
the
financial system?
No.
How it's working?
No. No. How does financial system contribute to economic growth?
Still
contributes to economic growth. Now of course he wants the answer. The answer is it contributes growth by channeling savings to the most productive investments and the most productive capital. In other words, the function of the financial system is to channel to most productive capital and investments. The function of the financial system is to channel savings to the most productive investments and capital in the economy. In the economy. Let's see if I have something else. I see I have about 3, 4, 5 minutes, right? Well, let me see if I finish. I need 3, 4, 5 minutes. Okay. Now, the way they write it in the textbook, and I want to make sure, interest rate is the price of a loan. No, so it's the price of capital, the cost of capital, the price of a loan. Okay, next time. We finish this chapter. Okay.
Teacher, we need review for the next year.